He is one of Britain's leading writers, so it's a great pleasure to welcome once again to this programme Colin Wilson. But he's not in our studios here in London today. Today he's in the BBC Southwest studio down there in Plymouth. Mr. Wilson, welcome back.
Thanks.
Now, the last time we chatted was about your book called Poltergeist. Uh-huh. But now I'd like to go back a little bit further than the book that came out last year of that title and talk to you about a book called The Outsider, which I think came out in about 1954.
56.
But you started writing it in 54.
Yes, that's right. Christmas 54, I started it.
And that's got to be the book that put you on the pathway to being totally and utterly a writer.
I was totally and utterly a writer before then, but I'd been writing a huge novel called Ritual in the Dark, based on the Jack the Ripper murders, for the past 5 or 6 years. The Outsider was kind of offshoot of that, because the book about the Ripper murders was full of outsiders, social misfits, and I thought I may as well write a book about this and siphon off some of the intellectual cross-references in the novel.
Was that an easy thing to do?
Yes, very easy. I was explaining the theme of Ritual in the Dark one day to a friend, and I said, you know, the three central characters are quite different. One is an intellectual, but he doesn't have any control over his emotions or his body. Another one is an emotional person, has great control over his emotions, but not over his intellect or his body. And the third one is almost entirely physical, terrific physical discipline, but no control over his intellect or his emotions. And then suddenly I saw I got a book.
Right. You also had three extremely displaced people, from the sound of it.
Yes.
Much of your writing deals with displacement, doesn't it? Or the occult, black magic, and things of that nature, parapsychology?
Well, that was, in a way, a distant development from the theme of The Outsider. You see, The Outsider, of course, was a success partly because it came out the same weekend as Osborne's Look Back in Anger, and they labelled as angry young men, and suddenly, you know, boom, we'd taken off. A tremendous amount of publicity that went on for well over a year. Tremendous number of attacks, too, as the press got fed up with all the publicity. This, you see, was the period before the Beatles. The people who were getting all the publicity at that time were Marlon Brando, Elvis Presley, Marilyn Monroe, and the angry young men in England and the Beat Generation in America. It was a completely different sort of scene. And I was the only one of that generation who was very concerned with problems of the human mind. They were all left-wingers talking about the need for getting rid of the Queen and the Archbishop of Canterbury and all this kind of thing. You know, Kingsley Amis and Lucky Jim and Look Back in Anger, Room at the Top. I was the only one who was concerned with these problems of the human mind and what's wrong with us. I'd always had this strong feeling.
Where do you think this feeling originally stemmed from in your own life? Because it must relate, I think, to something in your own makeup, your own psychological makeup.
Well, I suppose the feeling of being an outsider was to some extent due to the fact that I was born in a working-class family in Leicester, had to leave school at 16 and go to work in factories, and I just hated this feeling of being a kind of mouse on a treadmill, you know, being paid £5 a week, and it looks as if I'd do this for the rest of my life, as my father had done and as my brother still is doing, this kind of thing. And so the feeling that there's something wrong with the society that doesn't give you any kind of opportunity.
Right.
Of course, I proved to be mistaken about this.
Could you tell me why you got into the occult and black magic and white magic?
Well, what it always interested me was the fact that human beings are capable of these tremendous moods of sheer happiness. That had always fascinated me. What the psychologist Abraham Maslow, about whom I wrote a book, called peak experiences. These sudden experiences when you just bubble over with sheer delight. Now, it seemed to me that we spend an enormous amount of our lives in a condition of misery and irritation, and then quite suddenly we get these strange moments when suddenly everything seems all right. You get this feeling, I was mistaken all the time. The world is a beautiful, marvellous place, and it always has been, and it was my fault. I was stupid not being able to see this. Now, these moments give you such a feeling of clarity and certainty that obviously if we could learn to bring them back at will, we'd in a sense have the basic secret of what human existence is all about. Now, it was this interest of mine in that strange corridor of human consciousness that seems to run away from normal, everyday, boring consciousness that had always fascinated me. And as soon as I began to study this question of the occult, let's say of telepathy, for example, you suddenly begin to realise that here is an example of some power which all human beings possess, and yet which we do not seem to be able to control any more than we can control the peak experiences. And suddenly I saw there's a very close connection between the so-called occult and the things that had always fascinated me.
And has your attitude to what you've just described changed over the years, the more immersed you've got into it? Has your attitude changed at all? Are you still in the dark?
My attitude hasn't changed, no. But in some ways, I've found the trick. You see, the trick I always wanted to know was, how can we induce peak experiences at will? That's the interesting problem. And the answer's got to be to know more about the human mind. You see, our problem at the moment is we're so mechanical. We've all of us got inside as a kind of robot that does things for us. So you learn something like driving a car or learning to type or talking French, and you have to do it painfully and consciously. Then the robot takes it over and does it far more quickly and efficiently than you can. Now, this is marvellous. The human beings have the most efficient robot of all animals, but he also does things we don't want him to do. Let's say you listen to a piece of music that moves you deeply, you go for a walk that strikes you as absolutely delightful. The next time you listen to it or go for the same walk, it's the robot listening to it or walking instead of you, and you don't enjoy it. In other words, he takes over things we don't want him to do. You know, he can sort of even make love to your wife. And this situation of the robot living our lives instead of us, that's the real problem. As soon as we get into these strange situations, you know, like Graham Greene, I love telling that story of how Greene found a revolver in his brother's cupboard and played Russian roulette. He was in a state of extreme depression, put one bullet in the revolver, spun the chambers and pointed it at his head. And when he pulled the trigger, there was just a click. And he looked down the barrel and saw that the bullet had now come into position, so he'd missed death by just one. And he said he had an overwhelming feeling of sheer happiness. Now, you can see, there is a simple method of inducing the peak experience, but it's highly dangerous. There must be less dangerous methods, and that has been what has always fascinated me. And right. That, in a sense, is what I think I'm beginning to discover.
OK, I think that's not a particularly good thing to advocate, though, is it, to get to a peak experience or control your biorhythms?
Absolutely
or
not, because what we really want to do is to find out the psychological mechanism that made Graham Greene so happy, and, of course, the psychological mechanism that made him so depressed in the first place, which is to do with the robot. You see, when he pointed the gun at his head, the robot is just like the old man of the sea, you remember in the Sinbad the Sailor stories, who got his legs around Sinbad's neck and made him carry him around until Sinbad finally managed to make him drunk, and then he was able to get the old man off. Now, alcohol does it, of course. It gets the old man of the sea off your shoulders. But as soon as Graham Greene pointed that revolver at his head and pulled the trigger, the old man gave a shriek and leapt off his shoulders, and suddenly he was free. And this is it, this freedom from the robot.
The subconscious, maybe.
The subconscious, in a way, is the area of freedom. That's where freedom comes from, yes.
But is it not also the thing that drives you along in a robotic way?
No, not at all. You've got to distinguish clearly there. You've got two halves of your brain. One part is the logical part, that's the left brain. One part is the feeling part, that's the right brain. And then apart from this, you have an enormous area underneath, which is the subconscious. And this is the really interesting part.
Yes. And this, also, it's a part that has consistently interested people over the generations, hasn't it?
This problem of freedom has interested absolutely everybody. It's the great basic problem of all philosophy.
Now, the occult and what you just said there is not all you write about, because I note that in 1974 you wrote a book called A Book of Booze.
Yeah, I did that partly to get my wine off income tax. But in the same way that I wrote a book on music with the idea of getting some of my records off income tax. But again, booze interests me simply because it's so connected to this whole problem we're just talking about. You see, what I argue in that book is that sometime, maybe as long ago as 10,000 BC, man discovered how to make alcohol, and I think it could have been one of the biggest evolutionary advances of the human race, because when you drink, you cease to be all tied up with your present life, as it were, jammed in the present. You relax and get that strange bird's eye view of your own life. You get outside yourself. And it seems to me that this could have been one of the greatest advances that man ever made. Perhaps it's evolution. Perhaps it's alcohol that's caused us to evolve in the way that we have.
Certainly one of the most interesting parts of our evolution, I think, booze. And certainly one of the most consistent, really.
Yes.
I ask you how Sex and the Intelligent Teenager assisted your tax position? Because that was a book of yours.
Oh, that was simply a kind of appendix to a bigger book called Origins of the Sexual Impulse. And again, it's about this basic feeling of freedom. the fact that we never feel so clearly that strange feeling of sheer delight as in the sexual orgasm, that feeling of, my God, yes, it was okay all the time. True. And once again, if you analyse any of these things, your state of mind, for example, when you relax under alcohol, your state of mind when you suddenly experience that feeling of enthusiasm under a sexual drive, all of these things suddenly give you clues to the peak experience. You see, an interesting thing about human beings is that we appear to be the only creature who can masturbate. I mean, it's true that monkeys appear to do this. I mean, they do it in cages, but only in the presence of another, of a monkey of the opposite sex, a female.
Right.
Human beings can actually conjure up some sort of mental picture of a person of the opposite sex and produce all of the normal effects. This is pure imagination, and it's the most extraordinary capacity that we've developed.
Well, you learn a little every day. I never knew that. Among your other books is a book I think you brought out in 1961 called An Encyclopedia of Murder.
Mm-hmm.
Do murders slot into different groups?
Well, yes. In The Outsider, I wrote a chapter that didn't actually get into the final book called The Outsider as Criminal, that began with, by talking about Jack the Ripper and so on, and saying that this was another type of protest of the same kind as Van Gogh and Nijinsky and T. Lawrence and so on. Later on, I decided to write a whole book around this theme of the outsider as criminal, and it's preoccupied me ever since. In fact, at the moment, I'm writing an enormous world history of crime that'll be a quarter of a million words long.
I would have thought it would have been even bigger than that, something of the size of the Encyclopedia Britannica.
It could easily be, because there are so many murders. In the 20th century, the murders that are actually documented would occupy a volume as big as Britannica.
Right. Most of the murders, though, are domestic, aren't they?
Yep, and one third of all murderers commit suicide, so basically there's not a great deal of interest there. What is interesting is that the types of murder are slowly changing. For example, when I wrote the Encyclopedia of Murder in 1960, I commented that there appeared to be a new kind of murder that was just beginning to appear, what you might call motiveless murder. A man was sitting watching a programme called The Sniper on television and just walked out of his house with a gun and shot a total stranger through the window. Now, that was totally new then in 1960, and I observed this and said, you know, this is probably what is going to happen. And, of course, over the next 20 years, suddenly you get the motiveless murder. Things like the Moores murder case, the Charles Manson murders in America. Dozens of similar cases. This has become the most common kind. The age before that was really the age of sex murder. Although we're still getting sex murders, we're definitely moving right out of that age. And a century before that, you did not get sex murders. They just didn't occur. Nearly all murders were basically economic or domestic. Mm-hmm. Jack the Ripper was the first sex murderer, and that was 1888.
Do you think this change in the stimulus for murder is a reflection of current society and the changing society over the years?
It's partly the fact that there's far more leisure nowadays and far more sexual stimulus all over the place. In other words, as soon as people become bored, have nothing to do, they tend to turn towards sex as the obvious way out of boredom and into an intenser state of consciousness. And this is what they're after all the time, the intenser state of consciousness, freedom.
Can I talk to you about The Directory of Possibilities, another book of yours,
uh-huh.
that deals with controversial and spurious knowledge?
Yeah.
I mean, how did you go about collecting all these bits? You must spend so much of your time, though, just either thinking or working in research areas.
Yes. Everybody, I think, is fascinated by this whole peculiar area of what you might call, I don't know, nutty information. Everything from UFOs and the Loch Ness Monster to ghosts and poltergeists. They're not things that can be taken terribly seriously. But when you begin to look into them, you suddenly find that there are patterns, that it's not complete nuttiness. For example, in the case of the Loch Ness Monster, we think, well, it may be some ancient thing, an ichthyosaurus or something of the sort, dating from a long time ago. We suddenly realise that in some of the lochs in Ireland where these things have been sighted and where there's very sound evidence that they exist, one whole boatload of Catholic priests saw one of them, and yet the loch is too small even to support a fairly smallish monster, the explanation could be that the monsters are not simply physical creatures, that in some strange way they're all tied up with the human mind. They are, in a sense, I think, a kind of poltergeist.
All right. I sat at home last night and I watched a film called Altered States.
Oh, Ken Russell's, yeah.
Have you seen it?
No, but I suspect Ken borrowed some of my ideas. He's an old friend of mine. And I wrote a book called The Black Room, which is about altered states of consciousness under sensory deprivation, which I gather this is about.
That's right. It's based on the Paduchievsky book, I think.
Yeah?
But if you get the chance to see it, go and see it. I mean, the first half hour is very boring, but after that, all hell breaks loose. And it's exactly... It relates to what you're talking about, that sort of subconscious drive, or that constant search of all of us to discover what makes us do things every once in a while that we don't quite understand.
Yeah.
What makes you go on writing books? The assumption would be, A, that you have, as you've indicated, a pretty safe and secure knowledge of our tax system, so that allows you to duck and dive, if you want to put it that way. Or, is it called tax avoidance, I think?
That's the phrase, right, yes. Right?
So you can get into that. So what makes you continue to write?
Well, it's partly money. You see, writers don't make much money in England. If any of my books had been filmed or something of the sort, I might possibly be rich. As it is, I've got a permanent overdraft, and I need to continue writing. When I met old Compton Mackenzie when he was in his 80s, I said, God, you must be a rich man. He said, if I stopped writing tomorrow, I'd be starving next month. And I'm in the same position. So that's one reason. But, of course, I'd write in any case. I'm fascinated by ideas. I love ideas, you know, in the same way that a sailor loves the sea. It's something I just couldn't stop doing anyway.
What sort of mental condition do you like to leave your reader in after he's completed a book of yours?
If possible, intellectual excitement, thinking for himself. It's enormously easy, in fact, for anybody to really get into a state where they suddenly begin to see the relations between ideas and to learn that they can, to some extent, control their own lives through them. For example, when Maslow, whom I mentioned earlier, started talking to his students about the peak experience, they began remembering peak experiences they'd had in the past but had forgotten about, you know, that they just accepted like swallowing a boiled sweet. And then, as soon as they began remembering these past peak experiences, they began having peak experiences all the time.
It's a matter of tuning yourself in.
Absolutely. A matter, in fact, of getting out of a robotic state in which you're staring hypnotically in front of you, as we do 90% of our time, you know, sitting on a bus just staring out of the window. We're not using our potential freedom. And this is what fascinates me, the enormous amount of freedom we have, and that we only recognise when it's suddenly threatened. Human beings know what they don't want far more clearly than they know what they do want.
Probably down to the fact because nobody has ever been able to work out why we're here.
Well, yeah, this is the problem. Somewhere deep down inside us, I think, we do know. You know, Auden says in one of his poems, I have no reason to despair because I am already there. And again, in these deeper states, you get that funny feeling of, my God, of course. And then later, you can't remember what you were saying, of course, about.
Utterly confusing, but always interesting. Colin Wilson, I thank you very much for your time down there in Plymouth. I wish you a very happy day.
I think it's a pleasure.